Hello everybody, welcome. Today's topic is UPS selection and sizing. And at the end of this short lesson, we will be able to understand and to specify a UPS classification. We will be able to size a UPS with reference to the inrush current of the load, and we will make some comparison with other technologies. We will be able to size a UPS taking into account the power factor. We will be able to specify the energy efficiency, or better, the energy performances of a UPS according with the last standard. And at the end, we will discuss the protection of UPSs. Before to start, let me spend a few seconds in a very rough comparison between available technology for reserve of electrical energy. Basically, today we will concentrate on static UPS. Indeed, static UPS are the most diffused around the world, but we have also other solutions. For example, we have dynamic UPS or also gensets. Indeed, these are different technologies, so with different pros and different cons. Static UPS cover a very large power range, let's say from nominally 1 kilowatt to some 100 kilowatts. Dynamic UPS are available since let's say 100 kilowatt or probably more, 200 or 300. Genset are available from tens kilowatt to some megawatt. The storage capacity is moderate for static UPS, low for dynamic UPS, and theoretically infinite for genset. The transfer time is almost zero, or zero for static UPS and dynamic UPS, quite high in comparison with some kind of load for genset. Operating time is shown in the table and does not require any comment now. And also the line referring to the cost, even if I am not so convinced that is low for static and high for the other solutions. Indeed, the other solution present higher cost, but simply because of the power is also higher. So, done this this comparison, let's concentrate basically on static UPS, and let's start with their classification. First of all, let me mention the meaning of UPS. Since last decade, approximately, I don't remember exactly, probably 2003, UPS changed its meaning. That is, in the past it was an uninterruptible power supply. Now, formally, it means an uninterruptible power system. This is because it's not just a product. Power supply is just a product. System is something a bit more comprehensive and probably also a bit more complicated. With reference to the actual language, system is something in between a single product and an installation. In the past, again referring to more than 10 years approximately, system simply mean installation. Now, probably not formally, but practically, these two meanings are different. So, this is a UPS, a static UPS. Static UPSs are classified with a series of 8 letters, as shown in the slide now. The first 3 letters, AAA, the blue ones, are describing the dependence of the UPS output from the input. The red ones, BB, are describing the quality, the type of the output, the first one in a normal operation or bypass, and the second one in battery operation. If we have a S, this means that the output is sinusoidal. The last 3 letters, the green ones, CCC, are describing the dynamic behavior of the output of the UPS with reference to the change of mode, to a step of a linear load, or to a step of a non-linear load. The most important characteristics of the UPS are the first 3, described by the first 3 letters. So let's go a bit more in detail. The first type of UPS, also historically, is called VFD, that is voltage and frequency dependent. And the layout is the one now represented in the slide. With the network, the energy flow to the load through the green line, and at the same time recharge the batteries. Typically, voltage and frequency dependent UPSs are also called passive standby, and looking to the market, practically we have a full correspondence between these two classes, but theoretically VFD does not mean necessarily passive standby. Without the network, the flow of the energy is the one shown now, that is from the battery through the inverter to the load. That is, I have to change this path of the energy, moving from the presence of the network to the supply from the batteries. The second type, again, also historically, is the VI UPS, that is voltage independent UPS, or also called, but we can repeat all the comments we said for voltage and frequency dependent, also called line interactive. The scheme of this UPS is the one shown now in the slide, and the load is again fed directly from the grid through the static switch, and at the same time recharge batteries. But thanks to the bidirectional inverter, the voltage output can be adjusted by the UPS also in presence of the grid. Without the grid, the load is fed directly by the batteries in this way. The last type is the type VFI. This means voltage and frequency independent, also called double conversion. The scheme is the one in the slide now, and in the presence of the grid, the energy flowing the green path is converted twice from AC to DC to charge the batteries and to supply an inverter that supply the load. From this double conversion, the name of the class. Without the network, the energy is provided to the load by batteries. And in comparison with the first scheme, we can understood immediately that we have not to switch anything moving from grid situation to battery situation. In this table, I tried to compare these three main type of UPSs. The first one is the simplest, indeed, is also the cheapest, and but as usual, when the cost is limited and the sophistication is limited, we have some limits. For example, we can expect a dip in the supply moving from the grid to the battery operation. And in any case, the output, as described in the name, is dependent from the input. The second class is something in between, line interactive, is again quite simple. It costs a bit more than a passive standby. We still have a dip moving from a grid to battery operation, and the output is dependent from the input only from the point of view of frequency. The last line is dedicated to the double conversion. This is the most complex layout. The cost is the highest. We don't have any dip moving from grid to battery operation, and the output is fully independent from the input. I also add a column with the efficiency of these three types, and for the moment let's just say that the most efficient is the first one, and the less efficient is the third one, simply because if we want to convert twice the energy, indeed we have to pay something in this conversion. By the way, differences from this point of view among the three classes are changing in the time, and probably also the numbers I mentioned now are not definitive. Let me conclude just saying there is a type of UPS better than another one. No, indeed, it depends on the application. If I am interested in high efficiency, a dip of 10 milliseconds is not a problem for my load, indeed a passive standby could be a good solution. If my load cannot have a dip at all, the double conversion could be the best solution. Line interactive is in between. Each time I have to perform this kind of comparison with reference to my needs. Let's spend a few seconds for dynamic UPS and also for genset. In a dynamic UPS, the energy is provided by diesel engine and then its fuel, and this diesel engine is coupled with an induction junction flywheel to a synchronous generator. The synchronous generator is coupled with the network and the load by way of a large inductance. So the energy is again stored in something chemical, in this case the fuel and not the battery, and the transfer time is zero, exactly like the double conversion UPS. But indeed this is a mechanical equipment, and so the problems the designer has to face are not limited to the electrical world, but involves also fire protection issues and mechanical issues, indeed also from the maintenance point of view. More or less is the same for a genset. Also in this case the energy is provided mechanically by a motor supplying a generator, and the generator is coupled with the load. But in this situation the transfer time is not zero and is quite large, from 10-15 seconds for diesel fuel to half a second for flywheel. In any case, we are introducing with genset fire protection issues and mechanical issues. But let's come back to our static UPS, and let's move to the sizing for in rush current. As we know, a lot of loads require during in rush a current much larger than the steady state current. Static UPS are able to provide also overcurrent, but for a limited time and for a limited value. If we have the network and we have a UPS with bypass, the limit is the limit of the bypass and the network. So we have to refer to the general theory of electrical installation. Just pay attention that typically the current, the rated current of the bypass is similar to the rated current of the UPS. So pay attention and don't believe that the bypass can provide an infinite current. With reference to battery operation, typically the UPS or bypass or without bypass, sorry, the UPS can supply, can provide 150% of its rated current for 1 minute, that is a quite long period of time, and 200% of its rated current for typically 100 milliseconds, so a quite short interval of time. This means that if the inrush current is longer than 100 milliseconds and larger than 200% the rated current, we have to pay attention. From this point of view, indeed, the power, the sizing of the power of the UPS is strictly related to the possibility to provide, if requested, the inrush current. Now let's provide an example. This example derived from a study I personally carried out a few years ago, and it refers to lighting appliances. and specifically to fluorescent lamps, linear or compact. The more or less also other kind of lighting appliances require quite large inrush current. So if we are using our UPS to feed also lighting appliances, we have to take into account the possibility to start them without the network. Our study was mainly concentrated on fluorescent lamps, and we took a lot, frankly now I don't remember how many equipment from the market. We supplied them with a UPS, let me say a UPS modified to be able to avoid the stop of the electronic protection and to be able to record the inrush current. In the picture we are seeing now, we are seeing the envelope of the root mean square value of the inrush current for a series of lamps. It's very small, but you can see that are more lines. By the way, it is evident that for the first segment, the current is much larger than the one in steady state, because on the right of this graph, the current seems zero, but it's not zero, it's simply the steady state current. How to check if the UPS is able or not to supply a similar load. We have to compare the overcurrent, the electronic overcurrent protection of the UPS with the inrush characteristic current of our lamps. And this is done in this picture. You can see a line, dark blue, with a shape different than the other one. This is the trip curve of the electronic protection, plotted in the same graph in which I represented the inrush current of our fluorescent lamps. If the two curves cross, this means that the system cannot work. That is, that the electronic protection of the UPS switch off the UPS. In this case, we can clearly see that the system is able to supply the lighting system in steady state condition on the right, under inside the red circle, but is not able to start them without the network inside the left red circle. So, conclusion, partial conclusion. Pay attention to the inrush current, and if needed, increase the power of the UPS to be able to provide the requested inrush current. Now, let's spend a few minutes on the same issue, but for dynamic UPS. More or less, the problem is still the same. That is, load require quite high large current, because indeed loads are the same, and the UPS is not able to provide any kind of transient current. Typically, for dynamic UPS, a dynamic UPS is able to provide 300% of its rated current, and this more or less is the limit to be considered. Let me spend now a few seconds also on the voltage waveform. A problem supplying a nonlinear load with a dynamic UPS can be in the voltage waveform. As we know, the voltage drop has more or less the same waveform of the load current. So let's refer to a Thevenin equivalent of any kind of network, including our network supplied by the dynamic UPS. If the voltage drop is limited, I can have also, in case of non-sinusoidal current, a quite sinusoidal voltage on the load, the last one on the right. But if the voltage drop is not negligible, the voltage is also distorted, like the picture in this moment. With a system supplied by a dynamic UPS, in comparison with a system supplied by the public network, indeed one important issue is related to the short circuit power, or better, to the value of the short circuit impedance, the short circuit reactance. This reactance is indeed much larger than the one of the public network. This means that with the same value of the load current, we will have larger voltage drops. If these voltage drops are non sinusoidal, the effect is very clear. I see a question. ECC means short circuit current. So, how to perform this kind of calculation? Just remember to take into account not the synchronous reactance of the generator, but the subtransient reactance, because with reference to harmonics we have to refer to the subtransient reactance, and how to limit the voltage distortion. Looking in the standard, I never found any reference. So my suggestion is to limit the THD to the generic allowed value in the public network. In Europe, according to 50/160, 80%. If any kind of load is able to work fed by the public network, that is, with the possibility to have a voltage distorted by 8%, it should work properly also with our dynamic UPS. Let's move to a nice issue again with reference to static UPS. That is the effect of the power factor on UPS sizing. Let's concentrate on the output of the UPS represented in the right lower corner of the slide. I have in any case an inverter, and typically I also have a filter. This filter is made with capacitors. So let's adopt three colors to represent the current provided by the inverter, the copper, copper is just the color, the copper-colored current. Red is the current drawn into the filter, and green is the sum of these two currents, that is the output current available for the load. Indeed, the maximum current that can be managed by the electronic of the UPS has no limit in phase displacement. And that is, with reference to the inverter, in the plan active power, reactive power, the possibility is to work in a circle like the blue one now represented. But the phase displacement of the current of the filter is fixed because the filter is basically a capacitor. So the sum, or better, the difference between these two current is fixed. And sorry, I have a problem with the network. Really, really sorry. I lost something. Okay, now it seems to work. The sum of the copper, current and the red current is the green current, and this means that the possibility to work for the whole system is another circle, but shifted on the right by the red current. Excluding the lower part of this circle, we have this this shape. That is, typically UPSs can work at 100% of the apparent power up to a Cosinus P equal to 0.8. Then they have to limit the output power to 100% of the active power, and on the left we have a region in which we have to apply a K factor to compensate the current of the filter. That is, if I have to feed a capacitor a capacitive load, I have to consider that it is not phased by the filter, the capacitor in the filter. Moving to energy performances, quite actual today. Losses in UPS are mainly in the electronics and in batteries, that is, in the UPS core. But they are also in the filters and in the transformers. So we can have filters on the line, so-called duty, or on the standby line. Since 2012, with reference to the European standard, but this is also IC 62040-3, the efficiency of a UPS is defined classically as the ratio between the output power and the input power. In the past, with reference just to 100% of the load. Now it is requested to specify this efficiency in four points, that is 25, 50, 75, and 100%. Indeed, this is just a conventional decision. We could have expressed, we could have measured the energy performance of a UPS as load and no load losses exactly as we do with transformers, but for UPSs the standard is written in terms of efficiency defined in this way. The standard provides also a minimum efficiency. and the minimum level of efficiency is different for different voltages. And in this slide, we are I represented 240 volts. And is different also with reference to the type of UPS. You can see on the left VFB, VI, VFI, VFI sinusoidal. The efficiency is growing with the power and is growing from the top to the bottom of our table. This is just one of the table from the standard that is to explain the concept. So when I buy or I specify UPS, I cannot specify an efficiency lower than this one, and specifying the efficiency, I have to take into account the type of the UPS I need. To be noted that conventionally the efficiency specified in the standard does not take into account, or I don't know if this is the right expression, for the moment let's use it, does not take into account the presence of filter or transformers. That is, the manufacturer is allowed to subtract to the value of the efficiency the figures shown in this table in case of presence of a filter or a transformer. For example, if I have a UPS with a standby input filter and a standby insulation transformer, like in this figure, even if I read for 100% in the datasheet a total efficiency 91.6%, this does not mean that the whole system will have this efficiency at 100%, because this is calculated subtracting 0.8 and 0.6 to take into account the transformer and the filter. So it is just to be considered. I can move up, or if this is still okay, I can accept. Indeed, what I have to avoid is to believe that the declared efficiency is the real efficiency of also for this kind of transformers. Sometimes standards are written in a conventional way that is to be clarified and taken into account. Let's now spend a few seconds on evaluating the effect of the variation of the efficiency with the load. In this graph, the vertical axis is the energy efficiency and the horizontal axis is the load. And let's compare three theoretical UPSs, the gold one, the yellow, and the light blue one. Looking to the efficiency at 100%, that is the only one efficiency specified according with the previous release of the standard, the best one seems to be the gold one. But if I don't use the UPS at 100%, indeed the real performances of the other ones are better than this one. That is, I don't have to pay attention to the maximum efficiency of my UPS, but I have to pay attention to the efficiency of the UPS in the working point I will have. If, as usual, I don't know perfectly the percentage of load that I have now or I will have in the future, indeed, a quite flat curve is preferable. Today, practically all manufacturer offers modular UPSs. This is very good from this point of view, because with the modular UPS, I start a module if I need, and the curve of the efficiency against the load is much more flat than in the traditional ones. Few slides more on efficiency. In this slide, I am evaluating, I am comparing the cost with reference to, let's say, Italian cost of energy, that is 10 euro cents per kilowatt hour. So the cost of losses of a UPS of 200 kVA loaded at 80%, that is loaded with 130 kVA. I am comparing four UPSs, four hypothetical UPSs, one with efficiency 96% at 80%, and the other ones 94, 92. And 90. Let me say that I am saying they are UPSs, but this graph is valid for any kind of equipment with this efficiency. So the cost of such equipment in 1 year for losses is for the 96%. Almost 5,000 euros. 2% is more or less 2,500 euros more, and so the one with the efficiency 90% each year cost more than the double. That is 2.5 times the one with the highest efficiency. And in this situation, I didn't take into account the cost of energy for the cooling system. Increasing losses, indeed, I have to increase cooling, and cooling is usually performed with electrical equipment. So imagine that the COP, the coefficient of performance of the cooling system, is approximately 3, I have to add 30% to this cost. And the situation is the one represented in this graph. So UPSs are working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Typically, efficiency is a very important issue to be considered in specifying them. Pay attention. The last topic to be discussed today is the protection of our UPSs. Let's imagine to have a double conversion UPS with transformer, duty transformer like this one, and with bypass. And let's imagine to have protected it with a residual current device at the input side in a system fed by a transformer, the one on the left of our slide. Let's start considering the operation with the network. And let's imagine to have a fault in this red point. The current fault is this red one, and so this means that the residual current device trip. Trip protecting the load without causing any dip or disturb on the load, also the faulted one, and transform this system into an IP system. So the second question is, do I have to take into account this and to protect the my system with reference to IT system? No, formally we don't have to do this because indeed in case of fault this will become an IT system, but this is a temporary IT system, and considering that the risk is proportional to the time of exposure, formally the standard does not require any additional protection. Another solution would have been to protect with RCD all each one and all of the loads, indeed better or not, is simply different. If I adopt this second solution, defaulted load trip and does not perform its service, but all the other ones will continue to work for an infinite time and not limited to the battery capacity. In any case, adopting the solution I represented, it's important to have an alarm of the trip of this protection to avoid problems. In case of battery operation and with reference exactly to the same situation, if I have a fault here, again, I have the trip of the protection and the system is protected again, also without the network, when the energy is provided by the battery. The situation is exactly like the previous one, including all the possible comments. If the load is fed by the bypass, the current is a bit different, is this one, but again, this fault current, this residual current, allows the trip of our RCD protection. And so the system is still protected. The same applies exactly if the fault is before the transformer. That is, if the fault is here, the fault current is another one, is this one, but it is good to require to the trip of our protection. That's all. As usual, let me refer to our handbook and power quality.